Assalaamu Alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is part 3 of the parts of As-Salaat, or the composition of As-Salaat, and we carry on with Al-Faatiha. My dear sisters and my brothers, if we follow the school of thoughts and everything and the mass of the Faatiha recitation, we end up with nowhere to go really, because all of the arguments that they have is you must recite Al-Faatiha. However, it is enough for us that Allah has given us the option to read any part of the Qur'an, and that He would accept our Salat. As for the arguments presented by the other people that your Salat is not voided, your Salat is not accepted, who are they to say that? They are not with Allah of when He accepts and when not. If Al-Fatiha was an essential, integral part of the prayer, Allah would have mentioned it. Of course, they have all these kind of arguments that they provide, but at the end of it, it's enough for us what Allah says, فَقْرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنْ. Read in your Salat of the Qur'an whichever is easy for you. And that is that. Let me mention to you something that is extremely disturbing. Because of this conflict, there has been a lot of problems behind this conflict of Al-Fatiha and other parts of Al-Quran. And this is a very well-known conflict between the scholars about, as I said, the historical hadiths, where on one end they say something, on the other hand they say something else, and then they disagree with each other, and then they fight and everything. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Ubay ibn Ka'b and few others were of the opinions that Al-Fatiha and the last two surah of Al-Quran, Al-Mu'awwidhatayn, Qul A'udhu bi Rabbil Falaq and Qul A'udhu bi Rabbin Nas, aren't part of the Quran. And this had spread amongst other people. The following hadith in Al-Bukhari will tell you what to which level and which degree this problem had spread. Zir is a follower of the companion, is a man that came after the generation of the companions, is said to have spoken to Ubay ibn Ka'b about some parts of the Quran. Zir had heard Abdullah ibn Mas'ud say that Al-Mu'awwidhatayn, Qul A'udhu bi Rabbil Falaq and Qul A'udhu bi Rabbin Nas, aren't part of the Quran. And this is a well-known fact, it's in Al-Bukhari and few other books of history and hadith as well. So Zir goes, this man goes to Ubay ibn Ka'b, one of the four people that the messenger told us to take the Quran from. And he told him, Ya Aba al-Mundhir, this is his nickname of Aba al-Mundhir, your brother Ibn Mas'ud is saying so and so, or is saying this and that. Al-Bukhari is notorious, is well known for this so and so. He said this or that, or so and so said this. And that is because when Al-Bukhari wants to hide something, he doesn't take the hadith altogether, he just takes the parts of it that he doesn't want you to know. However, this hadith has been explained by other people. And they told us explicitly, for example, in Musnad Ahmed, that what was meant was Al-Mu'awwidhatayn. But let me read you a hadith in Al-Bukhari, where Al-Bukhari manipulates the texts, or anyone who has written Al-Bukhari after him manipulates the texts. And they go the same thing, Ya Aba al-Mundhir, Ubay ibn Ka'b, I heard your brother, and this is the hadith now, or at least the translation of it, and it's in Al-Bukhari, as I said. Your brother Ibn Mas'ud is saying this and that. Ubay said, I asked the Messenger of Allah, and he said, now the Messenger of Allah is going to say, they were told to me, so I am telling them as part of the Quran. Then Ubay ibn Ka'b turns to the other one and he goes, so we are saying what Allah's Messenger said. Basically, the hadith reads in Arabic that he said kada wa kada, Rasulullah said kada wa kada, and we are saying kada wa kada. That's it. He said, we're saying this and that. The messenger said this and that. We are saying this and that. And these books of history are notorious. Bukhari is notorious for these things, really. But in Ahmed, as I said, and At-Tabarani, and the hadith is authentic, it is explained what was this kada wa kada, so and so. And it turned out to be that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was saying that Al-Fatiha wasn't part of the Quran, and that the man had asked Ubay ibn Ka'b about it. So, and as you can see, my dear sisters and my brothers, this is what we have, especially knowing that the Messenger of Allah had asked us or has commanded the believers to take the Quran from four people: Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Ubay ibn Ka'b, and Salim Mawla Abi Hudayfa. Out of these four people, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Ubay ibn Ka'b do not accept that Al-Fatiha and Al-Mu'awwidhatayn, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, are part of the Qur'an, and they say they are just a dua. That's why when they wanted to cut this argument, they said that you must recite Al-Fatiha in each and every Salat. You don't recite it, your Salat is not accepted. Why? Because whoever said this are of the opinion that Al-Fatiha is part of the Qur'an. To force people to accept it as part of the Qur'an, they issued this kind of directives, that you have to recite Al-Fatiha. The same thing for قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. If you notice to the people who follow the Sunnah, okay, they will recite them more often. After each Salat, you recite them. After Maghrib and Fajr, you recite them three times. Before you go to sleep, you recite them. And when you want to protect yourself, you recite them. You recite them. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Why? Because they wanted to cut off the argument that Al-Fatiha and these two, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, aren't part of the Qur'an. But as I said one more time, if you perform your Salat today, you only read the Qur'an, any part of the Qur'an, you don't read Al-Fatiha, your Salat is perfectly well. I do that in all my Salat. I hardly read Al-Fatiha. I just read it just like I would read any other part of the Qur'an. I would say Allahu Akbar and then make some supplications before and then straight away dig into the Qur'an. When you do like this, you will end up reciting different parts of the Qur'an because your Salat is no longer mechanical. You no longer recite Al-Fatiha and قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ Al-Fatiha and إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. You start digging deep in Al-Qur'an and take more from Al-Qur'an than what you say. I will reserve some other parts to the book, but for now this should be more than enough. My dear sisters and my brothers, we all know that the Messenger of Allah stayed on earth as a messenger for 23 years. He never ever went on top of the minbar or sat in a halaqa, in a circle, or gave a talk to people about how to pray. He never did that. All he did was himself pray, and that's all he did. The Messenger of Allah never held any workshops and sit here, bring the companions, I'm gonna show you how to make wudu, I'm gonna show you how to perform a salat, I'm gonna show you this, I'm gonna show you that. Never ever. All he did was he prayed. Why? Because people knew automatically how to pray. And that's why there is not a single hadith where a companion tells you, oh, one day the messenger stood up and he taught us how to pray, or told us how many rak'at are in dhuhr or asr. Even when one day a group of young men came to visit the Prophet in Al-Madinah, and this hadith is reported by Malik ibn al-Huwayrith, and this hadith is in al-Bukhari. Malik ibn al-Huwayrith is the man who reports one hadith, and out of what he reports became a big problem, and that is what people call the jarst al-istiraha. It's usually when people finish a rak'ah, before they stand up, they sit a little bit, and then they stand up. That little sitting there is called jarst al-istiraha, rest sitting, and then they stand up. Malik ibn al-Huwayrith is the narrator of such an act. But anyway, this Malik ibn al-Huwayrith said, we came to the Prophet and we were a few young men of approximately equal age. We stayed with him for 20 nights. Then he thought that we were anxious for our families, and he asked us whom we had left behind to look after our families, and we told him. At which point the messenger ordered him and his friend, Malik ibn al-Huwayrith, and his friends to go back to their families, and then he told them. What he told Malik ibn al-Huwayrith is extremely important. Look at what the messenger says. Return to your families. Teach them the Qur'an and order them to do good deeds. فَعَلِّمُهُمْ i.e. al-Qur'an, وَمُرُهُمْ to do good deeds. and pray as you saw me pray. Subhanallah. 20 days and nights, these people came from far and the tribes to see how the messenger prayed. He didn't teach them. He just prayed and they saw, watched him how he prayed. They saw him how he prayed. So now he's telling them, and pray as you saw me pray. And when Salat is due, then one of you should make a call for it. And then one of you should move forward and lead the Salat as an Imam. And this is in Al-Bukhari. And this is extremely important. He didn't tell them, and pray as I taught you to pray. Pray as you saw me teaching. No, he tells them, and pray as you saw me pray. And that's why Al-Albani wrote a whole book with so many different prints, description of the Prophet Salat, from the Takbir, in the beginning, to the Taslim, to the end. And he based his book on a hadith known, very well known in the Muslim world, and the hadith and all the and fiqh sphere, hadithul musi'u fi salatihi, the hadith of the man who badly performed his salat. The story goes like this. Abu Huraira reports that Allah's messenger entered the masjid, and then a man entered the masjid and prayed. The Prophet had already prayed, so he was watching this man pray. And the man went to the messenger and said, Assalaamu Alaikum. The Prophet answered him back, but told him, go back and pray again. You have not prayed. I.e. perform your salat one more time. Your salat is not accepted, or you have not performed the salat. So the man went back and prayed in the same manner as he did before. And then he returned and greeted the Prophet. At which point the Prophet tells him again one more time, go back and perform your salat, for you have not performed your salat. And this took place 3 times. And then the man says to the messenger, by him who has sent you with the truth, I cannot do it in a better way than this. Please teach me how. So they said that the messenger told him, when you stand for a salat, say your takbir, the first takbir, Allahu Akbar. Then recite from the Holy Qur'an of what your heart knows. And this is another evidence that any Qur'an you recite will do. Because the Prophet didn't tell him in each rak'ah recite al-Fatiha. No, he says, ثُمَّ قَرَأْ مَا تَيَسَّرَ مَعَكَ مَعَ الْقُرْآنِ. So read whatever is present with you from the Qur'an, anything. And then the messenger carries on. Then bow in ruku', then prostrate until you are well leveled. Then you raise your head and stand up until you are totally straight up. Then prostrate in sujood till you are well leveled, i.e. perform your sujood perfectly well. Then raise and sit well leveled. And do the same in all your prayers. Subhanallah, this is the salat that the messenger taught the companions. Extremely simple, extremely beautifully simple. You come in a salat, you say takbir, Allahu Akbar, recite anything of the Quran from you. When you bow, bow perfectly well, try to do the 90 degree. Well, if you can't, do the best of what you can, then you stand up until you're fully erect. Then you put your head on the ground. He didn't teach him what to say. He said you make your prostrations, then you sit, you make your prostrations, and you stand up. And this is a salat. This hadith of the man who badly performed his salat is the foundation that has led the scholars to make so many debates, so many arguments, everything. And as you can see, the Prophet didn't mention any tashahud. He didn't tell him, and you make the tashahud and you say this and you say that. So, is the tashahud part of a salat or is it not? When this element of the tashahud always gets brought up when people want to weaken the position of the Quran. They always tell you, oh, if the Quran by itself is enough, how did we learn how to make tashahud? As if tashahud itself was part of the salat. As if tashahud itself was part of the equation. You tell them the Quran is enough, and they get back at you, how did we learn tashahud? The Quran doesn't have tashahud. But the Sunnah has it. That's why we need the Sunnah to pray perfectly well, so that Allah accepts our prayers. And on top of that, my dear sisters and my brothers, ask any sheikh about at-tashahud, and they will all happily tell you that you must read the tashahud in your salat. Otherwise, your salat is invalid and not accepted. So anyone who tells you that your salat is not accepted, they have taken a seat by Allah and have decided along with Allah if your salat is accepted or is it not, which of course is absolutely untrue. Before I go in details about the tashahud, let me say that I will not go into explaining what each version of the tashahud that I am going to mention means. What matters at this stage is just to mention the different versions and any special comments if needed, because if I'm going to explain, it's going to take forever. Up front, I want to say that there are 13 versions of the tashahud. But because the length of the talk and it's going to take forever, I'm just going to mention 9 of them, of these different versions of the tashahud. Without, as I said, I'm not going to go into explanation, the meanings and all that kind of stuff, but rather I will just tell you where the tashahud, what the tashahud is, who the narrator is, the school of thought, if any, and perhaps few words here and there. And without any further ado, let me start with at-tashahud. And I want to say this, any tashahud that you know, you only know it because one school of thought had decided that tashahud is the authentic version that they should teach you. So you grew up with that version, you only recite it. But should you travel around the world, you will find other Muslims that perform their salat, but do say different tashahuds than the one that you are making yourself. There are many books of hadith and well-known hadith and scholars and all that kind of stuff around the world, as I said, who have like Bukhari, Muslim, and hadith of Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, and all these kind of books of hadith. They all have different versions of this tashahud. And I will later on mention why we end up the reason behind the tashahud. The one tashahud that is famously known in Saudi Arabia, and because of the money they spread it around the world, is the tashahud of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who says, "Allamani Rasulullah wa kaffi bayna kaffayhi tashahud." Allah's messenger, I'm going to just say the English, yeah, except the tashahud wordings. Allah's, so Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is saying that Allah's messenger taught me the tashahud, and he was holding my hand in between his hands, just as he would teach me the surah from the Qur'an. And this is extremely dangerous, as we shall see. So Rasulullah is taking the same approach of teaching something as he would usually teach the Qur'an. Or is this addition by the scholars to give authority to this version? And we will see that this happens in more than a tashahud. Which, in other terms, Rasulullah has held the hands of so many companions and ends up teaching them wrong tashahuds because they are all different of each other. The tashahud that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says is At-tahiyyatu lillah wa salawatu wa tayyibat. السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وهو بين ظهرانينا. And the messenger, when he was with them, they would say this, but when he died, they used to say Assalamu ala nabi, peace be on the Prophet. They would not say upon you, Messenger of Allah. So this is one version of at-tashahud. The second version of the tashahud goes by Abdullah ibn Abbas. The narrator is Abdullah ibn Abbas, who says that Rasulullah used to teach us the tashahud as he would teach us a surah from the Quran. And he used to say, التحيات المباركات الصلوات الطيبات لله, as opposed to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who used to say التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات, and then he goes السلام عليكم. But Abdullah ibn Abbas says التحيات المباركات الصلوات الطيبات لله, So the question to ask was, and this one is in Muslim, hadith is in Muslim. So the question is, did the Messenger of Allah teach at-tahiyyat, al-mubarakat, al-salawat, al-tayyibat lillah, assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi, or did he teach them at-tahiyyat lillah, wa-salawat, wa-tayyibat, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah? You might say, hey, no big difference, it's a word, no big deal. I'll tell you, it's a big difference. Because if the narrators, who the transmitters, have made an error of the transmission, the text that the Messenger of Allah transmitted, then that makes the other ones, where Rasulullah didn't hold their hands and didn't speak to them in public, as Abdullah ibn Abbas says that he used to teach us, as he would teach us a surah from the Qur'an, because if he taught them at tashahud as he would teach them the Qur'an and they got it wrong, what makes us then accept that the Qur'an, they didn't do something with it? It's extremely, extremely dangerous. Because the first version and the second version are not the same. They are different versions. That's why one of the Wahhabi sheikhs of Islam QA was asked about this. What are all these different versions? He goes, the best Muslim is the one who learns them all and then varies. One time he says this and one time he says that. So that means they all are at the same level. And because if you make tashahud, or because they make tashahud compulsory, then all of them are to the same degree. Which in fact is not true whatsoever. Listen to again Abdul Rahman ibn Abdul Qari, who heard Umar ibn al-Khattab again while on the minbar teaching people. So here we are now, Umar ibn al-Khattab standing on a minbar and teaching people how to make at-tashahud. And this hadith is authentic and reported in al-Muwatta of Imam Malik. And he said, at-tahiyyatu lillah, az-zakiyatu lillah, at-tayyibatu as-salawatu lillah, assalamu alayka ayyuha. From assalamu alayka ayyuha nabi, it's all the same thing. But the difference is at the beginning. So this one here is at-tahiyyatu lillah, az-zakiyatu lillah, at-tayyibatu as-salawatu lillah. And according to Imam Malik, this is the most authentic version, because Umar ibn al-Khattab is a companion. He taught it to the companions from a member, and none of them had objected. And because of this, all the North Africans and all the Maliki school of thought consider this tashahud as the most authentic. They just do this and they don't do anything else. And I say, what made Umar teach people something that was different than that which the Messenger taught Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Abdullah ibn Abbas? What? Why did he do that? What made you do this, Umar ibn Khattab? Especially that the first hadith is in Bukhari, the second one is in Muslim. Was Umar absent when the Messenger taught it? As Abdullah ibn Abbas, that he used to teach them the tashahud as he would teach them a surah from the Quran. So was Umar absent when the Messenger did it? Didn't Umar hear that the Messenger had already taught them a different version of the tashahud? Didn't Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Abbas keep what the Messenger had taught them to themselves? Did they keep it to themselves? Didn't they tell it to other people so that people realize what Umar ibn al-Khattab, the third version, is different than the two first versions? Assuming that the Messenger taught the tashahud right after he arrived to Al-Madina, how come Umar stayed ignorant of what was taught to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and to Abdullah ibn Abbas for the next 13 years until he became the leader and then he taught it to people? Who gave Umar the authority to teach people? And why didn't Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Abbas stop him? Why didn't they? Maybe they were not in the masjid. But then again, if they heard, why didn't they go to him and tell him, look, what you taught people is not what the Messenger. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud would tell him, the Messenger had held my hand. He had my head, both his hands were on top of mine, and he was teaching me, say this, and I would say it. Abdullah ibn Abbas would teach him, would tell him, no, the Messenger used to teach us all this tashahud. But then again, where did Umar himself get this version of the tashahud? Who taught it to him? My dear sisters and my brothers, these are different versions, but then again, another fourth different version to what it is. And this one says, At-tahiyyatu, as-salawatu, at-tayyibatu, as-salamu alayka, ayyuhal nabi. That's that. And this is by Al-Khatib Al-Baghdadi in his book of Taqeed Al-Ilm, Documentation of the Knowledge, and is also reported by Abu Dawood and others, and this hadith is authentic. And I say, shouldn't it have been enough for our sheikhs? What was enough for the companions? Why didn't our scholars just wrote and study the Qur'an all alone? Why did they have to write the tashahud with it? Why did they go beyond that and add tons and tons of other humans made up hadith? Why didn't they just study the Qur'an and let's say the tashahud? And so far here, we've already covered four different versions, each one of them to be the pinnacle of the tashahud. Each one of them says, this is my tashahud. Let me go to the fifth version. The fifth version is in An-Nasa'i and in At-Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and is authenticated by Al-Hakim, and the hadith is authentic, where the narration goes something like this. And I'm talking about the tashahud. So as you sit for your tashahud, you would say, Bismillah, wa billah, at-tahiyyatu lillah, wa salawatu, wa tayyibatu lillah, assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi. The fifth version is completely different, because you start with, Bismillah, wa billah, at-tahiyyatu lillah, wa salawatu, wa tayyibatu lillah. The sixth version, that Aisha, the wife of our Prophet, used to say that when she says her tashahud, she would say At-tahiyyatu, at-tayyibatu, as-salawatu, az-zakiyyatu lillah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, assalamu alayna wa ala ibadillah as-salihin, assalamu alaykum. That's when she ends her salat. And this hadith is in Muwatta Malik. Remember the hadith that Umar ibn al-Khattab stood up on the minbar, taught it to other people? That was in Muwatta Malik. And the school of Maliki are adherent to what Umar taught. Yet again, they have another hadith of our mother Aisha, and the tashahud here is completely different to that of Umar. So wouldn't our mother know from her husband how to properly say the tashahud that Umar ibn al-Khattab has to teach it to her because he taught it to people from the minbar? Why would he hold the hand of a man and not his wife? I'm talking about the Messenger of Rasulullah. And to add to that, as I said, Malik has both hadiths in his Muwatta. What made him choose the hadith of Umar over that of our mother Aisha? It really is mind-boggling. The seventh version. And then again, it says, it starts with At-Tahiyyatu, At-Tayyibatu, As-Salawatu Lillah, As-Salamu Alayka, Ayyuhan Nabi. And this version is An-Nasa'i, and that's also an authentic version. The eighth version, and that is by Samura ibn Jundub, and this one is a companion, that he gave a sermon to people, khataba fi nas. So he was talking to a bunch of people. And then he said, amma ba'd, thereafter, amarana Rasulullah, the Messenger of Allah, had ordered us, had commanded us. What did he order you? Idha kana fi wasat as-salat, whenever he was in the middle of a salat, aw hina qida'iha, or when it ended, i.e. you are in the second rak'ah when you make the tashahud, or the fourth one when you are about to finish. And then he said, فَابْدَأُوا قَبْلَ التَّسْلِيمِ فَقُولُوا. So before you say, assalamu alaykum, and you finish your salat, here is what the Messenger taught Samura ibn Jundub, and Samura taught this to the people that he was given a sermon to. التَّحِيَّاتُ الطَّيِّبَاتُ الصَّلَوَاتُ وَالْمُلْكُ لِلَّهِ ثُمَّ سَلِّمُوا عَلَى الْيَمِينِ ثُمَّ سَلِّمُوا عَلَى قَارِئِكُمْ وَعَلَى أَنفُسِكُمْ. What this means is this. So the Messenger taught the companions, and one of the companions is teaching others, and he tells them that the Messenger had ordered them specifically to say At-Tahiyyatu, At-Tayyibatu, Was-Salawatu. Then they added a completely new word, and that word is Wal-Mulku Lillah, and the kingdom is to Allah. And then forget Assalaamu Alaikum Ayyuha Nabi wa Rahmatullahi wa Barakatuh Assalam. Forget all that. Then they straight away, they would go Assalaamu Alaikum to the right, Assalaamu Alaikum in front of them, and Assalaamu Alaikum to their left. And this hadith is authentic and is in Abu Dawood. The ninth version, I'm getting tired really, and I'm sure you are as well, with all these different versions. In the ninth version, that Abdullah ibn Umar. Now, Umar ibn al-Khattab gives a talk in the masjid and teaches people. The strange thing is, Al-Imam Malik in his Al-Muwatta, in his book of hadith, reports what Umar ibn al-Khattab said and considers it authentic, reports what our mother Aisha said and considers it authentic, and now will report a hadith that the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab said. So what, Umar ibn Abdullah, didn't he learn from his dad like any other one? So that now he tells us a new version of this tashahud? Well, as it turns out, the tashahud of Abdullah is different to that of his father. He says, Bismillah, attahiyyatu lillah, as-salawatu lillah, az-zakiyatu lillah, as-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi, till the end. And then at the end, he doesn't say, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. He says, shahidtu an la ilaha illallah, shahidtu anna muhammadan rasulullah. And I say one more time, how come Malik reports three hadiths? One by Umar, which he considers the authentic, and all the North Africans and any followers of the Maliki school of thought say that tashahud. And then another tashahud by the wife of the messenger, Aisha. And now he reports a third hadith by the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Here are my thoughts about on this tashahud, especially the nine ones. And no matter what they say about a tashahud, the truth of the matter is, they are as confused as any other. But to keep their faces in front of people, this man of the religion, they only mention and teach their followers one tashahud. And they make that one tashahud seem as if it were the only and lonely authentic tashahud in the whole salat. Read any other and your salat won't be accepted. And whoever is not saying the way they say it, their salat is invalid and won't get accepted. As if they had taken a seat besides Allah and decide whose salat is accepted and whose salat is not. The truth of the matter, I, Abdus Salam, don't use any of those nine tashahuds whatsoever. As a matter of fact, when I sit down in my tashahud time, all I say is I make dua to Allah. If I am praying to Allah, Allah doesn't need me to say, Ya Allah, I believe, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. I've been yanking it throughout my entire salat that I believe that Allah is one. Throughout my day, I am always living and saying, La ilaha illallah. And Allah doesn't expect me to sit at Salat and one more time, Ashhadu an la ilaha. Why am I praying? Is it not because the Messenger of Allah has brought the Qur'an? Is it not because in the Qur'an it says pray? Is it not because of all this? Why do I keep in every single Salat, keep saying to Allah, I bear witness that you are one, and Muhammad is your messenger. I bear witness that you are one, and Muhammad is your messenger, until it has become so automatic, so monotone, that it doesn't have any taste. I just say it and I don't care. And people say it in a class. They go outside there, they lie, they blaspheme, they backbite, they cheat, they steal. The Muslim countries are the most backward in the world. Yet, we all say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammad, as if our heart would change every single second. But that is not the case. So in my salat, when I say, I greet Allah in my own words, and then I make any dua, and I don't say, Assalamu alaikum ayyuhan nabi, I don't see it for a split of a second. He's dead. Why should I keep saying to him, Assalamu alaikum? My son is dead. I don't keep saying to him every morning I wake up, good morning, Mu'adh. I don't talk to my son. He's dead. I don't talk to my dad. He's dead. I don't talk to anybody. He's dead. Why do I keep passing the salam of the messenger? He's dead. But let me tell you, once you know the history of the tashahud, you will understand why all this malarkey, why all these problems are there. Before moving any further, let me tell you a little bit about the history of tashahud. How did it come to be part of a salat? So much so that they make a whole fuss about it. If you don't say it, your salat is not accepted. Who gave them the authority to rule my salat if it's accepted by Allah or not? Allah certainly didn't tell them if he accepts it or not, and neither did the messenger. The messenger himself never ever said it by himself. So, and we don't have an evidence for that. He didn't teach it to people, nothing. It's something that has been imposed on us later on. And once you know the history of a tashahud, you will understand a lot of the things. As I said, there are the few hadiths which tell us how tashahud started, things like that. I'm going to mention a couple of these hadiths. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud told us that we used to say in as-salat behind Allah's messenger. So they would pray. There was no tashahud. There was nothing whatsoever. So when they sat in where they make the tashahud nowadays, Abdullah says that they used to say, not Rasulullah taught them. If Rasulullah had taught them, they would have said what the messenger taught them. But since he didn't teach them, when they prayed behind him, out of their own selves, when they got to the tashahud portion, they used to say, Assalaamu Alaikum. Assalamu upon so and so. So they used to pass salam according to their whims and desires. Each one would pass assalam to anyone. In another hadith, they used to say, Assalam be on Allah, Assalam be on Jibreel, Assalam be on Mikael. And if I love my mother, I would say, Assalam be on my mother, on my father. That's what they used to do and they used to say. So when the messenger heard them times and times and times and times, then he wanted them to say something better than what they said. فَقَالَ لَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ So one day, Allah's messenger told us, إِنَّ اللَّهُ هُوَ السَّلَامُ Allah is السلام. The name of Allah, one of the names of Allah, is السلام. فَإِذَا قَعَدَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي الصَّلَاةِ فَلْيَقُلْ So therefore, when one of you sits in الصَّلَاةِ, they should say, التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات All compliments, all prayers and pure words are for Allah. And then they say, السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام be upon you, O messenger of Allah and the blessings. السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. السلام be upon us and on the righteous subservients of Allah. And then the messenger tells them, if you say this or when you say these words, your words will touch every righteous subservient in heaven or on earth. And then he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. And then he said, then you choose of any dua for yourselves. And this hadith is in Al-Bukhari, Muslim and others. And this is a very, again, authentic hadith. It's in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So at-tashahud, as it turns out, is not a revelation or an integral part of a salat, but is rather a correction. The tashahud was a solution to a problem because the companions were saying this, peace on that. So the messenger taught them something to say better. And that problem was created by those who were behind the messenger. If the people behind the messenger hadn't said anything, we wouldn't be having any tashahud in our salat these days. Honestly, if they didn't say what they say, the messenger of Allah would never ever have the need to teach them what's known today as the tashahud. And we wouldn't be having this conversation at all. So now, which then raises the question of, how did the messenger say the tashahud on himself then? If that is the case, believed or not, scholars in the past were asked this very question. And they answered it in a manner that is really extremely strange. They say that the messenger used to say exactly like we say, only Allah knows of which part of the nine tashahud he used to say. And then when he gets to the part of where we say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, he still says it, that he bears witness that there is no other deity but Allah. And when Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, he says, and I witness that I am a messenger of Allah. And he says it to himself. And this really makes the whole thing extremely strange and funny. How can you testify to yourself that you're the messenger of Allah? Testifying is when someone sees something and says, I testified, meaning I was there. He is a messenger. He receives the Qur'an. He does what he does. He doesn't need all these things. And this statement that I said to you is authenticated by Al-Albani himself in his book about the description of the messenger prayers. And of course, all this is absolutely nonsense. For that, my dear sisters and my brothers, even if they tell you that tashahud is an integral part of a salat, you must do it. Otherwise, your salat is not accepted. Truth of the matter is, the tashahud is a man-made thing. And the reason they put it is because in the 3rd century, when Muslims mingled with different cultures, they found out that each culture was extremely praiseful of their messengers. The Jewish used to overpraise Musa, the Christians overpraise Jesus, everyone else overpraises their spiritual leaders. So for us Muslims, the tashahud was invented to overpraise the Prophet Muhammad, because Allah has passed the salam on all the righteous people, and the Prophet Muhammad is no exception from it. So in your time, when you sit down for your tashahud, if you choose not to make any tashahud whatsoever, as you used to, and you just make dua for yourself, that's even better. Even better. And let those who say your salat is not accepted meet you on Judgment Day. Because if my salat was not accepted, then who told them to? The Quran doesn't say that, and even the Prophet Muhammad doesn't say that. It's their own invention. I will now proceed to speak about the tasbih history in the ruku' and the sujood. So when you make your ruku', usually subhana rabbi al-azim, and when you put your head on the ground, the sujood, you make subhana rabbi al-a'la with the variety of different versions, subhana rabbi al-a'la wa bihamdihi, subhana rabbi al-azim wa bihamdihi, or just those two words, subhana rabbi al-azim. But again, there is a hadith that is in Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah and authenticated in Al-Albani, by Al-Albani, that Uqba ibn Amr al-Juhani, this is a companion, that tells us the following. When فَسَبِّحْ بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الْعَظِيمِ, which is a part of ayah of the Quran, so glorify the name of your Lord, the Most Great, was revealed. He said, the Messenger of Allah said to us, say it in your ruku'. And then when Allah revealed سَبِّحْ إِسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, and when glorify the name of your Lord the Most High was revealed, the Messenger of Allah told us, make it or say it in your sujood. اِجْعَلُوهَا فِي سُجُودِكُمْ. As usual, the usual stuff, scholars had disagreed and differed about the ruling on saying the tasbih in a ruku' and a sujood. Are we obliged to say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la when you make ruku, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, or not? Because the way it's now, they tell you you should say it 3 times. So we become like a robot when you, as soon as we bend over, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, and I heard people go like, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, and you hear nothing of Subhana Rabbi al-Azim and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And the majority of Muslims, 99% of Muslims, have no clue what they are saying. They just say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, but they don't know what they mean by it. You see, if you say, I am hungry, if I said, what do you mean by it? You say, well, my stomach is empty, and I am feeling this crunching feeling in my stomach, I need to eat. That's what it is, I'm hungry. But when someone says Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, what do you mean by Subhana Rabbi al-A'la? They will say, oh, we glorify Allah. But what exactly are you saying? What do you mean by that? What are you meaning by that? Glorification is not Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. You see, when Allah says in the Quran, Subhana Rabbika Rabbil Izzah, when Allah is not glorifying himself. He doesn't need that. But anyhow, when someone asked the Islam QA Sheikh at Al-Munajjid about a very interesting question, and the answer of the Sheikh will give you a good idea of the conflict that we still live on. The question goes something like this. We have an imam in a mosque in the area where we reside, and he says, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, when he makes sujood, and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, when he makes ruku'a. The opposite. Instead of saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim when he makes his ruku'a, he says Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And this Subhana Rabbi al-A'la should be made when we are in sujood. So this imam is just mixing them. He's not saying them in the right thing. So this person is saying to him, we've already spoken to the imam, but he doesn't care. He still keeps doing them. Why he's saying this? Because in the Wahhabi, in the Saudi, in the school of thought, things like that, if you mix them, then you are making errors and you should correct it with prostrations of forgetfulness. And if you do them deliberately, then your salat is void. It's not accepted. One more time. But anyway, the Islam QA Sheikh answers, and here is part of his answering. He goes, the scholars of fiqh differed concerning the ruling on the tasbih in ruku' and also while prostrating. And the majority of them that the tasbih is only mustahab, is liked, preferable. It's preferable that you say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la or Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. It's not compulsory. Yes, it's only liked. And then he goes, however, and there is always that however, which just waves the flag of problems. Imam Ahmed and Ishaq ibn Rahawayh and Dawood al-Zahiri, these are great scholars of the Salafi sphere, are of the opinion that tasbih is obligatory. So there we have it, a great number of sheikhs, they say it's mustahab, is preferred. We have three people, they say nope, it's not that, it's obligatory. And then the Islam QA sheikh added, and this is the correct argument. So he is of the opinion that it is obligatory. And then he says, since it is obligatory, then to say the proper tasbih in the right place, i.e. when you make the ruku' you must say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, and when you make the sujood you must say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, okay, in that order. And guess therefore, whoever deliberately doesn't make the right tasbih in the right place, or deliberately mixes up and inverts the tasbih between the ruku' and sujood, you say this in the place of the other and the other, and he goes, then their salat is invalid. Just like that, it's invalid. And he goes, and that's because the person deliberately left a wajib, an obligatory act. Then he adds, however, since the jumhur, i.e. the majority of the group of scholars, like Abu Hanifa, Malik and Al-Shafi'i and others, say that the tasbih is mustahab, is only preferable, all right, then the prayer is not invalid. Now, he's going to now issue the ruling. If the imam is following the opinion which says that tasbih is only preferable, then the imam's salat is valid and your prayer behind him is permissible. Yet, he should be advised and urged to adhere to and follow the sunnah, because following it, there is goodness, guidance and prosperity. The worshipper is commanded to do as the Prophet did in his prayer without increasing or decreasing. The Prophet ordered us to follow him when he said, pray as you saw me pray, and this is in Al-Bukhari. Therefore, it is not appropriate for this imam or any others to disagree with the sunnah of the Prophet, and by doing this, shall expose his prayer to invalidity. Completely, you bang your head. So if the imam sees that it's mustahab, it's like, then that's fine, he does as he likes. Yet, we have to tell him that what you're doing is wrong, and the sunnah, it's like the messenger was filmed and we have his film. Watch the film. He says that. Why do you contradict him? All these are opinions. Nothing more than opinions. And the horrible thing he did is he must be urged to adhere and follow the Sunnah. What Sunnah? The Hanbali Sunnah? The Wahhabi Sunnah? Because the Maliki, they have their acts and they call them Sunnah. The Shafi'is, they have their acts and they call them Sunnah. And I say, my dear sisters and my brothers, if three great scholars, as they like to call them, leaders of great school of thoughts, and behind them a huge fellowship of scholars, say that tasbih is only mustahab, i.e. you can, from the moment you start your salat all the way till you end it, not mention one time subhanallah, your salat is perfectly well. Absolutely, your salat is perfectly well. But we have the Wahhabi school of thought, the Saudi school of thought, they tell you, nope, these people are not following the Sunnah. As if it's only Saudi Arabia and their likes who know what the Sunnah is. My dear sisters, in conclusion to this point here, you can praise Allah with any expression that you like. When you make ruku, say to Allah what you want. This is you and Allah one to one time. I want you to imagine this. Imagine you are a king or a queen, and you're sitting on the throne, and people will come to you, and each one of them is going to glorify you in their own manner. One of them says you're the greatest, the other one says you're the kindest, another one says you're most beautiful. Each one of them says something that comes out from their heart. Then you're touched by them, because each one of them says something different to you. Now I want you, on the other hand, to imagine you a king or a queen sitting on your throne, and people come to you and tell you the same formula. You're kind. And the second one comes, you're kind. Third one, you're kind. Fourth one, you're kind. Fifth one, kind. You get sick and tired of it. The same thing here. If we all say to Allah, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, what have we said? But if you, when you make your own ruku', you make it a one-to-one experience, you and Allah. And this is what I do. When I make my ruku', I always praise Allah. At times I say, Ya Allah, how beautiful you are, how wise you are, how wonderful you are. At other times I say to him, while I am in making my ruku', I would tell him, Ya Allah, I'm so honored to be here prostrated right in front of you, showing you my gratitude. At other times I say to Allah, Ya Allah, I am absolutely over the moon that I can talk to you. People talk to celebrities and they feel over the moon. People get an autograph and they feel over the moon. And here I am today, bowing right in front of you, talking. Yes, I say this kind of things, because that's what it is. Allah doesn't need you to tell him he's the highest. He's already said it in the Quran about himself. And Allah doesn't need you to say he's big. He's already said it in the Quran about himself. Allah doesn't need you to tell him you're strong. He's already strong. But when you add, Ya Allah, how strong you are, how beautiful you are, how compassionate you are, this record better with Allah, and you get far more points for this than just being a pirate. SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah. And I tell you, when was the last time you really felt the impact of your tasbih on yourself? I don't think so. If you are like me for the rest of my 50 years or whatever of my prayer times, I just used to do them because that's what you need to do. But when I made the tasbih my own experience with my own God, I started enjoying it. Because every time I start my salat, I have no clue what I am going to say to Allah. Either when I am bowing, just ruku', or when I am in sujood, I have no clue. And then when I make my ruku', because also I don't recite al-Fatiha, I recite any part of the Qur'an, depending on what I read from the Qur'an, it creates an emotion in me, and then carry on from what I read in the Qur'an, I glorify Allah based on that, and then I move on. I don't need to become a robot saying the same thing. In other terms, just make it, be creative, be artistic, and be praiseful, be resourceful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm getting to the 55. I'll stop here and record the last one, and then inshallah we'll end up the talk here. Until the next one, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.